Before we get started with today's show, you know Ariel Helwani. You see him everywhere on ESPN. He's a really good MMA journalist, and he's got a great MMA podcast called Ariel Helwani's MMA Show. Some episodes he co-hosts with Daniel Cormier, one of the top five fighters in the sport. It's like me hosting a podcast with Russell Wilson. Just doesn't happen. Other times he talks to not only the likes of Conor McGregor, but also people like The Rock, Kristaps Porzingis, and Shaq. It's a great listen several times a week, every week. Ariel Helwani's MMA Show. Check it out wherever you get your podcasts. Also, we'll be closing out the Jordan Rules Thursday with author Sam Smith, but we hope you enjoyed The Last Dance, a behind-the-scenes look at the final championship of the Chicago Bulls dynasty. You missed it when it aired. All 10 episodes are up at ESPN+, and then listen to the wrap-up podcast with Jalen and Jacoby. Our coverage of The Last Dance is brought to you by State Farm. When you want the real deal, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Coverage is also brought to you by AT&T. The Jalen and Jacoby After Show continues this Sunday following Lance, part one of a two-part ESPN 30 for 30 film on Lance Armstrong's rise and fall in the sports world. Hear from Armstrong himself in a film that insists the audience makes its own interpretation on one of the biggest doping scandals in history. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to The Right Time. My name is Bomani Jones. Thanks for listening. Wherever you get your podcast, rate us, review us, give us 5 stars. You only give us 4 stars. I'm inclined to believe you are a hater. About that time of week where we have a guest on with us, joining us now, over there with his hairline down to his eyebrows, Michael Smith.
What's up, man?
Hey, man. You know, I'm just over here, baby. What's going on over there?
Not much. My hairline might be down to my eyebrows, but also I got hair sticking out the side of my fitted cap for the first time in my life. I ain't never had that before. Like that little, those little puffs on the side.
Not even with growing your hair out was in style. Was you too responsible as a college student to do anything experimental with your hair?
Oh, I did the experiment in high school. I had a little S-curl joint going. I don't know if you classify that as experimental.
I was thinking more like braids and twists or something like that. I didn't realize you was out there. Like, I have to say this about you. The most fascinating thing to me about you is that somehow you were not a cap.
I was approached by the Kappas. I was approached by, what was the other fraternity on campus that hollered? Because I went to Loyola, New Orleans. So we didn't have the most thriving Kappa community. We had a few. Who was it? I think the Alphas asked me if I wanted to pledge. That was just never my thing, man.
I could just see it. You got it, especially when you decided you got you an S-curl. Like Mike Smith in the S-curl era, that's all Kappa right there. Now, me personally, I wasn't about getting my ass beat.
I'm telling you, I wasn't about doing nothing I had to do based on somebody else's request. I'm not one of those how high when you say jump type people. So no, I'm good on that.
Nah, man, but everything's good over there?
Man, everything's good, maintaining. We got a dog now, dude.
No word.
Yeah, I broke down and got the kids a little puppy. So that's added some adventure to our quarantine life, you know?
Indeed. So you've been on I did your Instagram live about the Last Dance. Now, the thing I did not ask you when we did it before we talked about The Last Dance is I didn't know where you were on Jordan as it was happening. Like, were you a Jordan, like a Jordan file?
Yes, I was. Cause you remember in New Orleans, man, we ain't had a team when I was growing up. The Jazz left and you know the Hornets and then eventually the Pelicans hadn't moved there yet, and so like everybody else at that time it was just, you know, cool to run with the Bulls. And so my favorite team was the Warriors, the Run TMC Golden State Warriors. Uh-huh. I used to stay up late and watch them. Everybody rode for Jordan back in the day, you know, wearing the Bull starter caps, the big old puffy starter jackets, Chicago Bulls starter jackets that you had to like look both ways. Yes. Make sure you had everybody run up on you for wearing it, you know? So no, definitely.
See, it's interesting because I was not a like dyed in the wool Jordan fan. Like that's never really been like, I didn't dislike Mike or have any problem with him or anything like that. Like there was no, I can't appreciate why it is that he's Michael Jordan, but for whatever reason, like I was not a be like Mike type. I also grew up in a very interesting city with regards to Jordan in that, so like Houston had Olajuwon, right?
Right.
The number one item on Hakeem Olajuwon's resume to me is nobody in Houston ever complained that they didn't take Michael Jordan.
Never.
Right? Like that is that. I didn't grow up a Rockets fan. Like people have a hard time understanding and believing that. We moved to Houston when I was 7. I had all my teams before we got there, right? Mm-hmm. And I found the locals to be some fair weather bums when I got there. And so I wasn't really, hey, look, they know, Houston know how they get down, right? It's a real bottom line oriented sort of place. They know who they are. They know what they're about. But like the greatness of Olajuwon loomed over Houston in a different kind of way than I feel like it did in a lot of those other places. So like I always dug and got what Jordan was. But I admit that around like 2010, I was one of those people that was looking at LeBron and being like, yo, this is the best dude I've ever seen.
Really?
Yeah. And then I went on YouTube and was like, my bad.
You needed a refresher course. That's all you needed.
That was exactly what it was. Like, I feel like with Mike, and I think this is what happened with this documentary, it's one thing to have been aware of how it felt at the time. And people talk all the time about MJ was out there playing against a bunch of plumbers and all of that stuff, right? But you know what nobody ever says when they go back and watch that stuff? They'll never say that MJ was no damn plumber. Like, you pull up them clips and you know immediately what it is that everybody was out here talking about. Like, I'm thinking about, as an example, like I watched a Moses Malone YouTube video once, right?
Right.
You're going to have a hard time understanding what we're talking about here if you go watch a Moses Malone clip. Because it's just Moses Malone being Moses Malone, throwing the ball off the glass, banging into somebody, going and getting the ball and dunking it, right? Like if some kid looked at that and was like, oh, see what the big deal is, I could understand why they would say that. That ain't what happened when you go back and watch that Mike stuff. And they did that in this from episode one, from the college clips. You looked at that and you were like, oh, that's why we're here. Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
No, singular. I mean, it's funny. The idea that he was playing against a bunch of plumbers is ridiculous, but there is something to, he was so much more athletic and explosive than really anybody we'd seen. And you could just, there was such a, you look at the modern NBA now, and there's a lot of dudes that obviously patterned their game and tried to, like you said, tried to be like Mike. But back then, wasn't nobody playing like him.
No.
There was nobody doing what he was doing to the point, I'm going to tell you, in 10 episodes, do you know who had the best quote in the entire series to me? And you might have known that he said this. I did not know he said this. Like, you want to talk, people talk about, oh, do you look at Michael Jordan differently having watched it? I'm going to tell you who I look at differently and have more respect for is Bobby Knight.
Bobby, yes.
I mean, before he ever played a professional game, he said he's the best player I've ever seen.
I didn't know he said it. I didn't know he said it in such a level tone. Where he was just like, yeah, you know, we got this, we got that. And he's the best basketball player that I've ever seen. That's one man that we don't think is just gassing somebody up, right? Like that's not what we think about Knight.
He said he's the most competitive, he's the most athletic, and he's one of the most skilled, which makes him the best basketball player I've ever seen play. Literally, like you said, matter of fact, didn't blink, didn't smile, nothing. And it was at the 84 Olympics.
Yes.
I'm like, Bobby Knight is that dude.
Well, hold on. And keep in mind, this is only a couple of months after Indiana shut Jordan down in the tournament. Like, I got to say, if I'm Dan Dockage, I'm a little salty with ESPN. Why ain't y'all calling me about that time I shut Mike down in the tournament, right? Like, this is the Dan Dockage calling card. And this is for all the people who are too young to get this, who are listening. The biggest reason that Dan Dockage is where he is, like why people my age know Dan Dockage's name, is in 84, maybe the greatest Carolina basketball team that there's ever been. But Kenny Smith got hurt. They were a little, you know, they're a little banged up. Dan Dockage guarded Michael Jordan. Now, Jordan was in foul trouble for this game, too. But you go look up the box score of that game in the Sweet 16. Mm-hmm. Dan Dockage put what counted as the clamps on Michael Jordan, right? So even after having seen his own team with Dan Dockage shut Jordan down, apparently Knight doesn't think that's what happened, because Knight is like, no, this is the greatest player I've ever seen.
I want to take a quick detour because I want you to enlighten me a little bit more on that 84 team, Jordan, and that matchup in particular you're talking about. Because, you know, there was always the old saying that the only person that could hold Jordan under 30 or 20, whatever it was Dean Smith, that the system in some respects limited Jordan's true capabilities, the way that Dean Smith liked to play. How much of that was at play in that particular game? It's hard to imagine Dan Dockage locking up Michael Jordan. It's hard to put that together.
Yeah, so the thing is, in that particular era of Dean Smith basketball, and it changed as you got into the 90s, where those teams were a lot more exciting, but this is like in between those 90s teams and the Four Corners. So Smith's teams were always using a long stretch of the possessions. Like, you go through and you look at some of the point totals, that was always what it was. However, this particular team scored a lot more points. They just also happened to be like kind of loaded with players. Like, you got to think about it. Sophomore Brad Daugherty is on that team. Senior Sam Perkins is on that team. Freshman Kenny Smith is on that team. I mean, this don't sound much, but freshman Joe Wolf. Freshman Joe Wolf. Keep in mind, Joe Wolf played in the NBA for a long time. He was on that squad. They're just loaded, right? Like, it's not like they were not a team to just like roll the ball out to Mike. And Dean was never going to be a guy that's like just roll the ball out to Mike, especially when you've got a future number one overall pick playing at center. But Knight saw it right then. And I remember even Rod Thorne talks about this. He was like, look, if we had the number one pick, we would have taken Olajuwon too. But there were people that night who were like, yo, this dude might be the illest. Sonny Vaccaro, he saw it, right? It's a real disappointment that he was not in this documentary, because he's the dude that went to Nike and said, forget about giving money to any other guys. If we give our whole budget to Mike, this is what we need to do this year. And they looked at Sonny and said, are you willing to put your job on this? He's like, yes, I am willing to put my job on this. Like, he saw the totality of Michael Jordan. He saw the fact, he was like, look, you dress him in anything, it looks good. No matter what you, I mean, Mike's been testing the limits of that over the last 3 years. You know, but like, those were the people that saw it.
Has there been a better investment in the last 50 years than Nike into Michael Jordan?
I mean, no, that is the best example of upstart sees upstart. Like, gay recognized gay. That is the best circumstance, because the two, they come together and they help create the magnitude of what is Michael Jordan, right? Like, it's all there. And what I said, we talked about this when this guy first started. To me, the most amazing thing about Jordan is he jumped onto an NBA team as a rookie, and the whole squad was like, he's the best player on the team.
Within 2 weeks.
You and I both know how NBA teams work.
Yeah.
There's always one dude
that's
over there like, yeah, all
right. Right.
Okay.
Did Michael Jordan ain't carried a single bag, ain't got a single box of donuts?
You know what? I bet he did all that stuff, though.
You think so?
Because he was a college freshman at some point. Like, one thing about Mike.
Well, I'm talking about it in the NBA, I mean, with the Bulls.
But I'm saying, I bet when he got to the league, this is your role. Like, when he said the thing was, my game had to do my talking. He's like, I didn't have the standing.
He didn't have a voice.
To do any of that talking. I bet he did all the rookie stuff. I bet they called him rookie all the time.
They still recognize that he was the best.
They were just like, oh, okay, but he the coldest. Got it. Yeah. Look, I'll tell you this story. I think I can tell this, because I'm not going to put no names in it, right? I know somebody who knows somebody who lived in Chicago when Jordan first hit the league, right?
Right. That's a great source. I'm already in on this.
Yeah. All right. And she a bad one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mike wanted to holla at her. All right. So this is when Mike was single. So, you know, we good there.
Yeah.
Mike wanted to holler at her. And Moses Malone came and talked to her and was like, I'm telling you, the rookie, he going places.
Was the young lady sophisticated enough on NBA or Celebrity Matters to take Moses Malone's
she was sophisticated enough to know Moses Malone, right? So, but she had a man. She had a man. And so the Mike thing never happened, right? But later, years later, she was at same place with Mike, and she comes up to Mike. Mike looks up and says, I remember you. And why does Mike do this? Because everything is a cutthroat competition to Michael Jordan.
Everything is a slight, man. I was rewatching it. I guess throughout the week, been rewatching it. Dude, how are you supposed to act as an opponent of Michael Jordan? If you speak to Michael Jordan, he's insulted. If you don't speak to Michael Jordan, he's insulted. If you say something nice about Michael Jordan, he thinks you're being condescending. If you say something insulting about Michael Jordan, he's dropping 50 on you. It was incredible how he could take George Karl not speaking to him and be like, oh, okay, I'm going to show you. But if somebody says something to him, be like, I'm going to show you too. Like,
right. Well, that was the thing. George Karl was like, of course I didn't talk to him. If I said something to him, like, who was it? Nick Anderson. When Nick Anderson had the 45-823. I'm like, yo, Nick, what were you thinking? And somebody hit me up, think it was A-Dub. He was like, yo, he might as well. Either you say it or Mike makes something up.
Absolutely. What was the guy named? LeBradford Smith?
Bradford Smith.
Good game, Mike. I mean, even if he did say good game, Mike, even if it was true.
Right. Even if he did, Mike, so fierce. And look, LeBranford Smith, actually, I watched his brother play high school basketball. His brother was like 6'1 with a 40-inch vertical, right? Like, he had all the hops in the world, but he was like a 6'1 power forward type. So I doubt it turned into anything for him. Did you know, Michael Smith, you are enough of a football nerd to appreciate this?
What's that?
LeBranford Smith is from Bay City, Texas. Mm. A little small town to the east, toward the coast. He was on the same high school basketball team with a gentleman named Hartley Dykes.
What?
You remember Hartley Dykes?
Number 88, Hartley Dykes.
Yes.
Patriots drafted him, didn't they?
Yes. Now, keep in mind, Hartley Dykes.
I had his football car.
Yeah, Hartley Dykes was the number one football recruit in America coming out of Bay City. Like, to put it in context, if you read all the recruiting stuff about Randy Moss coming out of high school, it's all he's the best receiver prospect since Hartley Dykes. Like, Hartley Dykes was kind of the gold standard of this. How in the world did Bay City, Texas have those two dudes on their squads at the same time? Like, LeBranford Smith was a monster in college. Like, nobody really thinks about him now because he went to go play for the Bullets. And that's how things work out when you play for the Bullets. But, like, he was a wildly talented dude. He had a great game the same night as Michael Jordan had a bad game. His reward for putting up 37 in a game against Michael Jordan is to always be on the business end of getting destroyed. If I'm LeBranford Smith, I want to know why don't nobody ever talk about the 37.
Right. The schedule makers just did him no favors. You know what I mean?
It was the next night.
Maybe it could have been a month later. The second night of a home and home. Like, that, no, that was crazy. Like, so what, honestly, I ain't never heard of the dude before this doc. What happened to him? What was his career after that back-to-back situation?
He's an NBA player.
How long did he last?
Let's look that part up. That I don't remember. I do remember it was a bit disappointing him coming out of Louisville that I think there's some people expected a little bit more from him. Okay, he played. Damn. It looks like it might have been all downhill from there, buddy. The gentleman only got 3 years.
Ooh.
Yeah, he was a first round pick.
Listen, I'm not. I thought the documentary was brilliant. I'd love to have heard from him. But you can't talk to everybody.
Well, yeah, I think part of it is the fact that you can't talk to everybody. And then, as much as I would have loved to have heard from LeBranford Smith, he know why they calling him. Right? Hey, we're just wondering if you'd like to be in this documentary about Michael Jordan.
Right.
He knows why.
Yeah, you're right.
Think about Brian Russell. Brian Russell ain't answer that call.
Not at all. He's like, I'm chilling. He pushed off, and that's all there is to it. Like, watch the tape.
He didn't push off.
No, he didn't. I'm speaking as Brian Russell.
Oh, yeah, it's Brian Russell. Russell. Apparently, Carl Malone was like, nah, I'm good. Thanks.
Yo, how about Carl going on the bus?
That's what I say. He did his part. He did his part by going on the bus. I ain't got to be in this documentary because I went on the bus and told him congratulations after the fact.
I don't know how common that is. Do you?
I don't.
I mean, because it's like, look, it's one thing to see you when you're coming off the podium, and then we got to go on the podium, and we see you, you know, behind the curtain. That's one thing. It's one thing if, you know, I see you in all season, I congratulate you, or even mid-court after the game when the confetti's coming down. But to go on the bus and walk to the back of the bus, like, man, that you want to talk about kissing the ring.
But hold up, though. Like, if you're Carl Malone, you can't just assume that Mike is going to retire, right? And so if you didn't get a chance to shake his hand on the court, you might want to make damn sure. We know that Mike doesn't appreciate that sort of thing.
That would have been a slight too, right? We didn't come on the bus.
Yeah, there will be hell to pay. You know, I hung around here running, waiting on him to come over and do the right thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I thought that the 10th episode quietly was the best episode.
Why that?
And here's why. Like, I feel like now that the whole thing has aired, I'm not going to, like, talk bad about the documentary, but I do think that they had a challenge. And the challenge was that they were trying, and this is an ambitious undertaking. They were trying to tell two stories at one time. They were trying to tell the story of the one team and then trying to build all the way up to the point that gets you to that team. And so I did feel at some points that we never really, like with the 97-98 stuff where they have all the footage, you never got to stay in that season long enough to really feel it, right? So it's like, oh, wow, that's interesting. Dennis Rodman did this. Oh, wow, that's interesting. Scottie Pippen's doing this. Oh, wow, whatever, right? But I never felt like a mounting tension about the idea that these things were going on at the same time, right? Like it never really got there because you had to jump back and forth.
Well, without knowing the business part of it, and I'm just speculating here, could it be that it was one of those where the amount of footage that they had if it was going to be built on that footage, maybe that makes for two, maybe three episodes. Attempt to make it into this 10-part epic. Because I'm with you. Like, yeah. As soon as they start they tell a story, you know, the 98 All-Star game in New York, and then they go back, you know, to the founding of Nike and all that kind of stuff. It's like, so, yeah, I mean, I'm wondering if they just try to stretch it out at the expense of what you're talking about, at the expense of that commitment to 98.
This we know. We know that the NBA has had this footage for a while. We know that people at ESPN have been aware of this footage for a while and we're trying to figure out what to do with it. And we've got, like, whatever the personal interest is for Michael Jordan in putting out something that is, like, basically an autobiography. Because as far as I know, he hadn't written one, right? Like, this became for him, like, the 21st century version of an autobiography. And so all the people with their different interests come together, and they're just trying to tell two stories at one time, right?
Yeah.
Except for episode 10. Episode 10, there is one story, right? Because now the rest of the documentary has caught up to 1998, right? We are now done with the 97 finals. We have already done all the stuff for 98. And so now we're squarely in that place. And so what that meant was you could more easily lean into the 98 footage and some of that intimacy about having that footage in 98, as opposed to feeling like at times, oh, we got a clip of this one thing happening. It felt better at points, like we were in it then, right? Because the whole documentary wound up being in that current place. That's no shade to anybody and what they were trying to do. It's just that I imagine for a filmmaker, it's much easier for them to do episode 10 than it is to do all the other episodes. Like, how do I link a first round playoff series against the New Jersey Nets with wherever they were on the timeline at the same time, right? Like, how am I supposed to go back to talking about the 1998 season when I'm talking about them finding Jordan's daddy dead in the creek, right? Like, that's a lot to ask out of anybody. So once we got to 10, I was like, yeah, man. Like, I felt like I was there in episode 10.
Yeah, no, I definitely feel that. I definitely feel that. I think while it was ambitious and difficult, I feel like it was necessary, because I don't know if you could truly appreciate the magnitude of 98 without understanding every step of the way to get to that point.
You can't.
But they almost had to do it. The only other way they could have done it is maybe just gone straight chronological, but I don't think that kind of that's not as effective as bouncing back and forth, I don't think.
Well, I also think they had to do it this way because of the absence of any other big Michael Jordan documentary, right? Mm-hmm. Like, if you feel like, not that these stories hadn't been told before, but this story as it was kind of hadn't been told before, which means that you got a lot that you got to flesh out in the background in order to get this done. Like, not every Michael Jordan book or documentary that you're going to do is going to require you to delve deeply into his father dying, for example. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of different ways to do it. Like, if somebody was writing a book, like, I haven't read that book, When Nothing Else Matters, the one about his time with the Wizards. I have not read that one, but I'm sure it goes back in time and tells you things about Mike. But you don't have to get to the bottom of any of them necessarily to tell that story.
Right.
But if nobody had ever written a book on Michael Jordan, then that's what then that's the kind of thing that you would have to do. And so, no, I really liked the way that they wrapped it up, just because you kind of got that feeling there at that point. Like, wow, I'm really in this right now. The other stuff was great for nostalgia and to look back and to remember what had happened, you know. But I felt in the 10th episode immersed in something that I didn't have familiarity with.
From a writer and a storyteller perspective, and that's what you're speaking on in particular, like, I feel that for sure. My favorite, though, and you hit on a word a second ago, nostalgia, my favorite was one. Just because the energy that I felt with one, I just didn't feel it. And I mean, this is not a reflection on the execution or the rest of the story. It's just that the 17, 18-year-old kid in me felt a certain kind of way with one, even going back and watching one. Because I went back and watched one again, and just the, you know, coming out with, you know, the Been Around the World, you know, David Bowie, Let's Dance, you know, sample or whatever, coming out with that, going to rock, playing the highlights of young Mike with the gold chain, I Ain't No Joke, all the stuff we were talking about when he was just coming into the league, and just what a phenomenon. I feel like that was all in episode one. I just felt like a certain energy to episode one that just got me excited the way none of the other ones did. But you're right, from a storytelling standpoint, 10 was probably the cleanest.
That energy behind episode one was about us.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? 100%. It was about what we brought,
yes,
to it. You know, the excitement that we had about checking this out, and the music was flawless, right?
Yes.
Like that was the dude. I think his name is Rudy Chang. He's the music supervisor. He did the music for like Silicon Valley. I've never watched it, but apparently the music is a hook to that. I do think Rudy let us down with that Pearl Jam at the end. I'm like, come on now, you're gonna get us here with all this hip hop.
I guess it was a Chicago thing. I'll say that to my wife. I was like, I get the Pearl Jam.
But Pearl Jam from Seattle.
But no, but then you know how they rep Chicago though. You know what I'm
saying?
Yeah,
but I know Eddie reps the Cubs. I don't know much about Eddie as far as repping like Bulls. I was still like there, I was like, hey man, I feel like we could have done a little better here. Actually, Gabe, funny story, I want you to play the whole music over about Tell Right Fast.
Thank you for your patience. A representative from the right time will be with you shortly. Your current hold time is
15 seconds.
Hilarious.
Actually, though, my favorite musical thing in this movie now has to easily be Michael Jordan getting on the bus like he listened to some M.O.P. or something, right. He's coming on the bus, his head nodding, talking about kidnap that fool. And they're like, what you listening to? Kenny Lattimore. And not only was it Kenny Lattimore, he flexed on it with some old basket. Like, I got that new Kenny Lattimore. Ain't even come out yet. You know, like he tried to hit us like it ain't never been nothing better. Like, ain't never been nothing better in the world that ever came out.
And I like Kenny Lattimore, but that was a deep cut. Like, I was like, wait a minute. Like, of all the things you get hyped to is Kenny Lattimore. But it's also funny because just think about like where we were technologically back then. We didn't see what he was walking. He probably had a big ass compact disc player. You know what I'm saying? And that was pre-streaming days. Like, oh man, Kenny Lattimore. Did Kenny Lattimore respond to this? I don't know. He must have.
Oh, of course, Kenny. Of the did Kenny Lattimore respond to this?
What do you say?
Oh, he was like, yeah, I met Mike. I'd given him my music. He's like, I didn't know whatever song it was his hype music. And I'm like, Yeah, no, Kenny Lattimore. I can't imagine how excited Kenny Lattimore was when this happened.
So is Kenny Lattimore in your babyface club? Like, what? Because I mean, he fits the same genre. What are your thoughts on Kenny Lattimore?
Oh, I just find his music to be largely nondescript.
Gotcha.
It's just kind of there. Like, he got, it ain't my lane, right? Like Michael Jordan would be listening to like Will Downing, you know? Like, people have to understand this. Michael Jordan does not like rap. Mm-hmm. You know, but people don't quite get about the generation of age Mike is. Mike from the country.
Mm-hmm.
Rap didn't get to the country immediately, right? The country folks it took a while for them to come around to this idea of the rap music. Mike is not that dude. Mike's listening to Anita Baker. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know.
Which I'm good with. Which I'm good with. Especially if it's Anita. Anita Sade, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Sade's in a different class to me than like, I dig Anita Baker's music, but Sade's music is like so much better than Anita Baker's music. It got a different oomph to it. You know what I mean? Like, I'll say
better, but I don't want to go so much better. I feel bad putting that extra emphasis on it. But we're on the same page with that. Different paragraph, but same page.
Look, man, Anita Baker, and even like I say, I like Anita Baker's music. This is no shade, but she makes a particular brand of like auntie type music. You know what
For
I'm
sure.
saying?
Yeah.
But not like your fun auntie, right? Just like the music your auntie listened to when you're around.
Yeah.
You put that to work. You put Sade on the road.
It's transcendent.
Yeah. Like you set the crib up, you open the door, she walk in, and you playing Fairy Tales. I mean, it might go down, but she don't know.
You're thinking practically. I hear you.
We're
switching the subject matter.
But it's not just practically. I mean, the Sade band, like the band itself, is just watchers, right?
I put Sade music above Anita Baker for sure. It was you when you said so much.
That music, that shot. I'm just saying that Sade make you feel something different. That's all I'm saying.
I don't sit in the dark and listen. Yeah. When I was going through it, I didn't sit in the dark and listen to Anita Baker. I listened to Sade. But to your point, when you put it to work, it's different.
And that actually, I bet you Sade might be Michael. Like you go talk to Michael Jordan. And Sade, he probably, man, I still wish I could be Sade. Right? Like that's his generation. That's his lane. That's the whole totality of it. He came on the bus like he was listening to Slam.
He would fanboy to Sade. Like Michael Jordan would probably just he'd be in awe of her versus the other way around for sure.
Yeah, yeah, too, man. I'm trying to think what else we got that came out of this that jumped out to you.
What did you think about the end of, I'm sorry, I think it was in episode 7. What did you think about when he broke down?
I just found it hilarious that the man don't cry about his daddy dying, but he cry about, you know, how bad he wants to win. And apparently, we just got a snippet.
That's what I was wondering. Like, why? I mean, I know he said break, but I can't imagine what happened after that. So
Before. Apparently, he had been rolling. Like he had been rolling to get up to that part and talk about how bad he was to win. That's the thing for Mike, man. I don't know what Mike's supposed to do as an adult when the only thing that truly gives you satisfaction is destroying people. Mm-hmm. Right? Like that. He wakes up in the morning to destroy people. I've talked about this before. I don't know if I think I've talked to you about this, where I've always said that a reflection of what I consider probably to be a bit of a character flaw in people. It's people who really, 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 really like playing Monopoly.
I don't think we've had this conversation.
Yeah, yeah. Like, think about this for a second, man. Your idea of a good time is evicting your friends. Like that, you know what I'm saying? Like that's what you in this for. That's what you about. Right. Is that? And right. I bet you Michael Jordan one of those stay up all night playing Monopoly. Like, if I heard that Michael Jordan had an apartment that he was renting out, Michael Jordan would be the worst landlord in the world. He hoping for the day that you late on the rent so he can kick you out.
No, when you put it like that, though, man, like, because you think about, well, obviously Mike, you know, was involved in the production. His company was involved in it. It's like, what is it that would make Mike feel like this is something I want to do? Why would he say, okay, I'm going to sit down? Because even he said in that moment we're talking about, you know, I don't have to do this. Like, why did he do it? For him, that was a 10-episode opportunity to destroy him one more time, to destroy Zeke, to destroy, you know, Jerry Krause, to destroy LeBradford Smith, like even though he didn't sit on it. But the competition was probably brought out of him again in the making of his documentary. Like, hey, I'm going to make the most epic documentary and I'm going to relive all these moments that have defined me and I'm going to set the record straight. The push-off, he got pissed on the push-off part. You know, it's almost like, you're right, like the destroying of people, we kind of got a little taste of that again.
I think the level of competition that came out of him is not in the making of the documentary. It is preceding the documentary. The kids don't know who he is, man.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. The kids know who LeBron is. Like that whole
LeBron stuff was getting out of control a little bit.
But,
huh?
Right. That whole generation in 25 years, in all likelihood, is going to do these same things with LeBron. They're going to talk about LeBron in the way they did Michael Jordan. And so where baseball has Babe Ruth, who has been the indisputable best player of all time for nearly a century now, right? And look, people can make, and I get where people are coming from, but they're like, well, Babe Ruth didn't play against black people, and I'm here to tell you, if Babe Ruth played in the Negro Leagues, Babe Ruth would have hit 714 home runs, right? Like, he was worlds ahead of everybody else, but we got Babe Ruth, and Jim Brown is like in a similar space in the NFL, right?
I thought Bonds is your number one. Are you saying, like, the consensus?
Yeah, the consensus.
Oh, the Bonds is your number one, though, right?
And it's a tricky, these are tricky comparisons, but Babe Ruth is that guy. There's no
for
argument.
For sure.
Jim Brown, in a lot of ways, has been that guy, but football people don't care as much about arguing about that one thing, right?
Right.
But in basketball, Michael Jordan had become a Babe Ruth-like figure, and then comes LeBron James, right? And the machine is different now. And I do think that for Mike, it was like, oh, okay, let me make sure you guys know who I am, because if he doesn't do it, how else is it going to be done, right? You could be like, well, they can go look on YouTube. YouTube doesn't give you the context. YouTube doesn't give you the story. It doesn't put it all together. Now you doing polls and ESPN is finding that the millennials are overwhelmingly like, nah, Mike was the greatest of all time.
Was it Trey Young? I think I came across a tweet from Trey Young. He was like, you know, I wasn't born when a lot of this was happening. He was like, thanks for doing this. Now I got a better appreciation.
Well, dude, think about how much you don't, like, we don't fully remember, right? No. So you're born in August of 79. I'm born in August of 1980. Mm-hmm. How much we really remember in about the year he scored 37 points a game? We're not. You know, like we have watched it.
It's definitely not the context to your point. You might know the stat. We might know he averaged, 32-8-8. We might know he had, 13 straight triple doubles. We may know that kind of because we can look it up. But like the context of it, even if we did live through it, your memory kind of fades a little bit for people of our generation in particular.
Well, you know what context was helpful? Not really helpful, but it's just a reminder of what I wasn't taking in at the time. At that age, 27 years ago, there's no way for me to appreciate the magnitude of your father being murdered.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that to me is like, damn, that's messed up, right? But I got no real first person grasp of that range of emotions. I'm not an adult. You know what I mean? I can't. Yeah. There's a lot in that I can't, because his dad, let my eyes tell it is old. You know what I'm saying? This is what happened. He's the age of people. I can't, when people start talking about why he retired and everything else, if he wants to say, yo, my dad got killed and I couldn't take it, I'm not pushing anymore. That's a good enough answer for me. And so, looking back, I absorbed that time period much differently.
That's another thing that came out of this, how up the media can be. And I say it as a longtime member of the media, not only not being able to absorb the magnitude of your dad getting murdered, but then having it put on you. I can't imagine what that must have been like.
Well, here was my thing about that. The media absolutely should have explored that angle, but don't talk about it till you got something.
For sure.
You know what I mean? Because look, we have been hearing about you. Yeah, we have been hearing about you losing all this money gambling with these people. And then out of nowhere, your daddy turns up dead. If your editor calls you and says, yo, kick around on that, see what you get. That's legit. That's something you do. But you can't come out here and be like, hey, man, I don't know. When you think about it.
No, for sure. You definitely want to investigate what happened, but you can't just be throwing it out in some column being like, put a question mark behind it and feel like that legitimizes, putting that out there like that. But no, I just saw this last night. I didn't realize this. So him sobbing, we've seen the pictures for years of him on the ground after they beat the Sonics face down. But apparently the sound of him sobbing is new.
Yes.
Man, I was like, man, I don't remember hearing that. You felt that for real.
Yo, so I do have to say this, right? Because I do think that if Seattle puts Gary Payton on Jordan earlier, that series doesn't necessarily end differently, but it goes differently, right?
Fair enough.
But Jordan and the Doc saying, I had no problem with the glove. And then he comes behind it. Yeah, I had some other things on my mind. And I'm like, damn. I hadn't thought about what it must be like if you're on the brink of winning this championship without your father. And this is a thing that matters to you, right? Mm-hmm. That I think the stuff with his dad humanized him more than anything else.
I love that he talked about not having an entourage as we, describe or we stereotype an entourage, so to speak. And how he surrounded himself with security guys. Man, that Gus story was incredible. I didn't know about Gus. Yeah. I didn't know how close he was and how he had fill that void in his life or attempted to fill that void in his life as a father. So it's like, you see this dude being like, hey, everybody back up. Everybody back up.
Right.
I love how they brought it back to, wait, this is a guy that's supremely important in Michael Jordan's life.
I also like that it's also, Mike ain't bringing nobody around that's going to be snitching.
Right. You got law enforcement.
I would actually love to watch a documentary of the security guys of the NBA. I'd love to watch that.
They know everything. That's for damn
sure. Well, not just they know everything. They're an interesting set of dudes. Barkley's guy is a former cop in Houston. I love that dude. This dude, James, man. James, cool as hell. And it's funny thing, James, for whatever reason, won't talk to Dan. He just stares at Dan, right? Whenever Dan's there, he just ice grills him. That's all they do. And Dan tries to smile at him and make him laugh. And James just ice grills him. It's the only thing James does.
But he good with everybody else?
Oh, yeah. It's obviously facetious, right? But okay, he just ice grills Dan, but he's the guy, because I can imagine being security for Chuck. It's got to be extra tricky because Chuck likes people.
Exactly.
You know, so the bar. And the other problem is Chuck knocks people out. I mean, it's been a long time since Chuck has knocked somebody out, but he had to throw that dude out the window that one time. It's got to be extra hard being security for somebody who probably didn't have security before because they enjoy doing that themselves. All right, we'll be back with more of Michael Smith in a minute, but first, now more than ever, we have to look out for each other and count on each other. Marathon wants you to know that you can count on them for high-quality, top-tier gas. Marathon gasolines are formulated with STP additives. They keep your vehicle running at peak performance by optimizing fuel economy, removing those ugly deposit buildups and by reducing emissions. And right now, you can get 5 cents off every gallon every day with Make It Count rewards from Marathon. Plus, you can earn points for additional savings on fuel, airfare, hotels, and more. This is definitely a deal you can count on. It's quick and easy to join. Just download the free Make It Count app or go to makeitcount.com/radio. Start saving today. This offer is valid only at participating Marathon stations. Remember, wherever you need to go, be safe. The people at Marathon are behind you all the way.
Hey, this is Bomani. You have reached the right time voicemail. Say whatever you want. Get creative with it. But this is your place to talk back to the show. So talk back. Peace.
All right. This is normally where we get you telling funny stories and stuff, but we figured you might have had some questions about The Last Dance. Mike Smith, you ready for it?
Let's do it.
All right, Gabe, who we got?
All right, so our first voicemail comes from JD in Singapore.
Hey, Bo, long-time listener, first-time message leaver, I guess. I just wanted to ask if you had a favorite pair of Jordans, one of the ones that he wore throughout his career.
All right, Smith, it's funny. He asked if I had any favorite pair of Jordans from, like, his career, and I hear that, and I'm like, I mean, I may have, but I didn't own none of them. That wasn't going down in the Jones household.
Absolutely, like, not without your own money.
No. And what I did not have in the Jones household was my own money. I have like a sentimental affection though, because for the Fire Red Fives, because Fire Red Fives are the first ones that I ever wanted, right? Like, kid had them at school. It was the first time I remember looking at a pair of shoes and really wanting them. And that's when I learned that I was never going to get them. So at that point, I kind of stopped paying attention to these things because I was not going to get them. But there's a sentimentality to me to the Fire Red Fives that ain't never going away.
I'll stick with that theme, and I'll go with the Playoff 12s because those are the first ones that I bought my own money. Same thing. I ain't buying you no Jordan. So my first job was at Maison Blanche in the plaza in New Orleans, and I got a $300 check. For like 80 hours of work. Like 80 hours is $300 or something like that over the course of like 2 weeks. My first pair I ever bought for myself was the Playoff 12s.
And you know what? The first pair of J's I ever bought for myself were the Fire Red 5s in like 2012.
Yeah,
they
right?
didn't reissue.
So your collection is since 2012.
Yeah, absolutely. Because I had no money. You know what I'm saying? like that was when the bread started. And
I was like, okay,
look, man, I was getting bread, but I don't have expensive taste. I don't have kids. I didn't have anything. So that's why I got all these damn shoes. Because it was like, what else I'm going to do?
Yeah.
I tell you this, though, the threes, just as a style, as a design, they are the most like ambitious, revolutionary. The ones and threes is just like, oh, okay, y'all just decided y'all was going to change the game. Got it.
For me, in terms of style, is 1, 3, and 11. Those are the three, the looks that I like the best. But, like, just pick a favorite pair, independent of sentimentality. I'd probably say, honestly, I say Cement 4s. I go Cement 4s, actually.
I got the Cement 4s. I like those. The most underrated ones, though, are the 13s, because the 13s are all-purpose. You could take 13s as far up or as far down as you want. Like, the tricky thing about 11s is I be feeling like I need an occasion for 11s. I can't just be throwing on like 11s with some sweats.
They're
right?
all flashy for sure. I don't go past 14 personally, do you?
I have a couple that are past 14 that are not so bad.
Okay.
But as a lifestyle, I got some 29s that came out of pack. That's kind of dope. Okay. But as a lifestyle, I stick to the rivers and the lakes that I'm used to. All right, Gabe, who else we got?
Our next comes from John in New York.
I'm wondering what you and Michael think of the documentary's treatment of Jerry Krause. By the end of the final episode, I got pretty uncomfortable with the uncomplicated villain portrait that the director and the producers painted of him. It seems kind of unfair to really sully the man, especially when he's too dead to defend himself. And he did make a number of smart moves to put that roster together.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly think that he deserved more credit in the documentary. And I wonder if Mike said earlier, if this is just Jordan and his perpetual grudginess, and trying to hold on to that. That being said, you are limited to the things that people say about the person when you make the film. And was there a long line of people with all these nice things to say about Jerry Krause? Because it appeared that the only nice thing there was to say was that he was a good general manager. And the thing is, though, he was a really good general manager and does not get credit for that. And the things that happened on the back end there, they also had some god-awful luck in trying to build after the Jordan era. I don't know if you saw this. Apparently, he had an unfinished memoir, and NBC Sports has been putting out excerpts of it. And one of them, he says that Phil Jackson said that he wanted to go to Montana. Like, he wanted to take that time off. Like, this was – and I wonder. I think it's a fair question to ask. Would you put it past Phil Jackson to go tell Jerry Krause that he wanted the year off and then go tell the team that Krause didn't want him anymore to galvanize the team around the idea of his last year?
I would not.
And I'm not saying that's what happened, but yeah. I can see it being possible.
No, for sure. Listen, okay, so with that example brings up, look, if there are some factual inaccuracies, then that's unfair. If they're using the fact that he's dead to not being able to defend himself against accusations that are factually wrong, then that's one thing. But to your point about what people said about it, look, I thought they gave him plenty of credit for, you know, moving on from Oakland, bringing in Cartwright and building that contending team in the early 90s around Jordan. They gave him plenty of credit for that. They gave him plenty of credit. Even Reinsdorf talked about the kind of person he was. Like, they didn't overdo it. They didn't sing a love letter to him throughout 10 episodes, but they talked about that he was a nice guy. But the fact is, the quote unquote, the fact is, absent something like you're talking about, Bo, where it was actually, you know, Phil wanted to take the time off, the person who broke up the team was the GM. He wanted to rebuild the team. And he told him, this is it. Like, because Phil's not coaching there anymore and made Michael have to make a choice, wanted to trade Scottie. Nobody told him to answer questions so openly about trading Scottie Pippen the way he did. Nobody told Jerry Krause to do that. Like, a lot of what you heard from Jerry Krause was Jerry Krause sound bites. So it wasn't like what I'm saying is I wasn't uncomfortable because it wasn't like they were assassinating his character. They were simply saying this was the guy that was breaking up the team. And absent any other evidence, I don't see how that's wrong.
The problem that you wind up with here, and there's no way to work around this, the hero of the story hates him, right? The guy that everybody's rooting for hates him. It's hard to spin around that. I also think, though, I mean, I think the way that they dealt with and talk about Krause and the way that he dealt with Krause in the Hall of Fame speech was small. I do think that it makes Mike look small. But I also think it's a fair argument to make, as much as we say this documentary is the way that Michael Jordan wishes to be seen. It also made the point, and I think this is where we talk about it being uncomfortable, I could make the counter argument that, like, those clips of him, like, picking on Krause, they make Mike look bad, right?
Absolutely.
It looked cruel in the way they treat Krause.
Talking
which
about the stunted growth and all that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think that as much as we could be like, wow, they're making Krause look bad. No, I could make the argument that that was actually put in there to make Jordan look bad. Like, that shows the weakness in Jordan. It makes you feel bad for Krause in the moment. Right. It is not a flattering portrayal of him because there's nothing flattering about letting somebody talk to you like that.
Yeah.
But that stuff made Mike look bad. That was my thought on that. Like, that is not beating up on Jerry Krause. That is actually exposing Michael Jordan in a way that, honestly, I didn't think the documentary would expose him.
Yeah, and I would say it's slightly different, but I would say Scott Burrell and the way he dealt with Scott Burrell and the way he talked to Scott Burrell, in many respects, you could look at it and be like, damn, why is Scott Burrell letting Michael Jordan talk to him like that? But why is Michael Jordan feeling the need to call Scott Burrell every word?
Yeah, I do. Hey, I thought overall the way he dealt with Scott Burrell wasn't nearly so bad. But that first time you called me a hoe, man, we got to talk about it.
We got to discuss this. You know,
I think I told you this story. I was in college, man, and I was had something with this dude. And we was just joking. He was my roommate's friend. And I said something that involved the B word in his direction, and everybody laughed. And so I would see him later and I would kind of harken back to it. And then one day he just came in the room, he shut the door, very calmly looked at me and said, this is going to have to stop. And I just remember looking at him and being like, you're right and I'm sorry. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was just going to have to stop.
Yeah.
Scott Burrell had room to be like, hey, not that.
And that fear factor conversation was interesting. Like, I get he's the best player. I get he's the icon. I get all of that. But like, what are you fearing exactly? Like,
yo,
you know,
people
like,
were so scared of him.
We feared him. Like, why? He's a dude just like you, a man just like you.
But apparently there's something to fear because everybody did. Like, even when he was telling that, telling that Brian Russell story, Brian Russell talking that to him, and Karl Malone being like, he just young and excited, Mike, right? Like, everybody, whenever something like that happens, there's always some old head that's like, nah, he just, cause Mike relentlessly attacked. Like, that's the thing. If your world is basketball, I think Scott Burrell's inclination is just to let stuff slide. But look, man, BJ was like, yo, I stepped up to him. I didn't have no problems. Horace Grant, I stepped up to him. I ain't had no problems. I don't understand how nobody explained to Scott Burrell, all you got to do is push him. Because unlike Steve Kerr, Scott Burrell was in a different weight class than Mike. You know, on the upper side.
Mike looked like the smaller guy, ironically, what he was talking about. It's going to stunt your growth or, you know, those diet pills, whatever. Yeah, he definitely didn't come off well.
All right. But Gabe, who we got?
Next comes from John in Ohio.
Do you think MJ loves basketball, or he loves the fact that he can get his competition addiction and get his victories in it easily or most easily through basketball? And this ties in with the Right Time Book Club. The reason I was wondering this was because of the parts in the Jordan Rules where he's asking David Falk about possibly retiring from basketball and living off endorsements and whatnot. You think that was just some random BS from him, or is there something more to him that he doesn't care that much about basketball and just cares more about beating people at things?
I mean, I think he really cares about beating people at things. I also think he loves basketball, right? Like, you can't be good the way he's good, so technically perfect as a player, and not love basketball.
Yeah, 100%. Like, I don't think those are mutually exclusive. You know, I think it's both. And the way he worked and the way he committed and how seriously he took it tells me he loves basketball, which is inherently competition. So if you love competition and basketball falls within that, then it's one and the same. It's not like, you know, it'd be one thing to say, does he love money or does he love the things that basketball brought him and his fame brought him, or does he love the game? Those two things can be separate and apart. But if you love competition the way he does and it drives you to work the way he did to be as great as he was at basketball, then I don't know that those things are separate, you know?
Yeah, the only thing I've wondered, like, I think the part about basketball that was hard for him is that you had to do it with other people. If he could be as good at golf as he is at basketball, he would be a golfer because then he wouldn't have to depend on these other dudes.
It's funny you say that. And I don't know. I thought this to myself. I'm going to say it. I don't know if it makes sense, but I'm going to say it anyway. Mike was low-key a selfish ball player. Like, because there was so much throughout this documentary that he talked about that was about him and what drove him. And everything that motivated him was not, oh, okay, I want this for the team. It was like, no, I want to cook this dude for talking shit. I want to cook this dude for walking past me at a restaurant. Like, his motivation, and not saying that's all that motivated him, but there was so much that he just decided he was going to be great. And he was so singularly great that he could say, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z for whatever reason, and it's going to bring the team along with me. It's not going to come at the expense of the team, but the team is coming with me as I go and pursue my individual, whatever, you know, my individual goals. It was interesting.
Look, the biggest problem with the Kobe Bryant impression of Michael Jordan, right? And I don't mean that as judgment, right? But I mean, he patterned his game very much so about after Michael Jordan. The problem was that he just wasn't as good as Michael Jordan. And again, that's not shade to Kobe, right? But Mike, there was never a time where there was a better idea than giving the ball to Mike, right? Maybe if I give the ball to somebody else, right? But that's always the best idea is to give the ball to Mike. But like, if Kobe was as good as Mike, I wouldn't say half the critical things that I said about Kobe when he was alive. You just have to be as good as Mike to play like that. And nobody is that good.
Right. That's it. No, that's it. That's it. The best. I say, like, I don't want the ball ending up with Bill Cartwright at the end of the shot clock. That's not good offense.
No. Like, why would that be your idea? Like, why do you think this is what we should do?
Yeah.
I get it. All right, Gabe, we got more?
We got two more. Next is from Karima in New York.
Was anybody else curious at the fact that Juanita wasn't really mentioned at all in this whole piece? I mean, it was a great piece of work. I mean, I enjoyed it thoroughly. I just thought, I mean, nothing? Like, Jordan being at this height of fame and just everything that he has to balance, I would just think that perhaps there'd be a mention of, yeah, Juanita being maybe a rock solid person and keeping things balanced in life with the three kids and all that. Like, we saw 2 seconds of his kids, really, who got to really, like, say something in the piece. I mean, I just thought it was curious, her absence. Granted, yes, Jordan would have to grant permission for this. Juanita would have to agree to be on it as well, but this wasn't strange to anybody else.
All right, so, I mean, a lot has been made about the fact that Juanita was not in it, right? Did I find it strange? No. Why didn't I find it strange? Have you ever heard her voice?
No.
I did some, like, Googling to try to find interviews. I found, like, a couple over the last few decades or whatever it is. That's a space that she's never been in. I also don't know if, I don't think they asked her. I don't know if she would have said yes had they asked her. The kids were kind of thrown in at the end.
Yeah, I could have done without them, respectfully.
Yeah, and all they were talking about was Utah. Like, this was all separate from that. And so the reason I didn't find it to be as strange as other people did is, that's a part of things that Michael Jordan never wanted us to see before.
Yeah.
That has not changed.
Yeah.
He does not want you to see it now.
Right.
And that's that, right? Like, what I think that people are doing, and I think I would be careful about, is just making too many assumptions as to why she wasn't in it. Mm-hmm. Right. Like that's the, you know, and by the way, everybody that seems to have the questions about why she wasn't in it have assumptions about what they wanted her to say. You know, no, she was my stabilizer when I had the kids. What if the story that you're expecting her to tell is not the story that was there? Again, yeah. I have no idea, but I just felt like Mike only gave us basketball stuff prior, and he's only giving us basketball stuff now.
That's the point. Just because it was set in his house, just because the interviews took place in his house, doesn't mean he was trying to bring us into his home. Because, I mean, he's married now, for crying out loud. We didn't see his current wife. We didn't see his other kids. Like, this was not an intimate portrayal of Michael Jordan behind the man behind the logo. He wasn't taking us into his crib and showing us his trophy room and showing us his bedroom. And this wasn't MTV Cribs. This was basketball. And everything discussed in some way, shape, or form was directly connected. Even his father's passing, his father's murder, was directly connected to basketball and was something that he was comfortable discussing. But other than that, you're right. Like, when has he ever let us in like that? He wasn't about to start doing that now.
Yo, he's a grandfather. Did you know that?
No, I didn't. He has a young one with his
he's got
wife.
Two of them. He got twins.
Yeah.
Let me tell you this, though. I would not want Michael Jordan to be my granddaddy. Getting destroyed by gramps at everything competitive.
Yeah.
No, I don't want to play one-on-one, granddad.
I don't want to watch the 93 Eastern Conference Finals, granddad. No.
No. Mike don't want you to watch him win. Mike wants to beat you at something, right? Like, you know, little kids will challenge you to do stuff sometimes, you kind of like you'll ultimately win, because I don't believe in letting kids win, but you'll let them feel like they got a chance.
100%.
No. No.
And Michael justified, he'll be like, how is that going to help him when the chips are down? Got to train my grandson for when he in the trenches.
Let me tell you something, man. I'm trying to imagine if, like, when Mike's kids were, like, 8 or 9 years old, and somehow they had convinced him to play on the Super Nintendo against them in Street Fighter 2. And one of those boys beat Mike in Street Fighter 2. You know what would have happened?
He
would have become the best Street Fighter 2 player in the history of the world. It'd have been like that Simpsons episode where Homer goes to the arcade to learn how to play the video boxing game. Yeah. Mike right now would be the number one esports player in the world if he had just engaged in this once.
How you pronounce it? Is it Dalsim?
I think it's Dalsim.
Yeah, Dalsim. Like, who was the player on Street Fighter that when somebody got him, you're like, dog, you could beat me with Ken or Ryu. You could even shock the out of me with Blanca. You better not get Vega and beat me. Like, it just be annoying with certain people.
Dalsim and Balrog. Balrog couldn't even kick. Those are the two. You'd be like, man. Oh, okay, this is just disrespect.
Yeah, I'm gonna get you the lowest common denominator, the lowest person possible to kick your ass. Like, at least Sonic Boom me, dog. You know what I'm saying? at least do that. Yeah, Mike would have definitely
right here,
been the
right
man.
Here, my man right here.
Mike would have been that dude. Yeah, E Honda.
Yes, yeah, it.
Hey, Mike would have been that dude at the arcade with the quarters lined up over the controller. And then when he beats you, just kind of walk off a little bit, look around, and then come back and be like, all right, who's next?
All right, I would tell you right fast, my favorite arcade story ever. Yeah. So, you know, when you be like in high school, there's always one cat that's a little slow to catch up, you know, to the rhythms of everything or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. I admit that I was that kid, except in my crew. I was not that kid in the crew because there was somebody even slower than me, right? Okay. I always just had a way of doing the wrong thing at the wrong time.
Okay.
And so there's this game back in the day. I don't know if you remember it. Lethal Enforcers.
It was an arcade game. It was a first person shooter.
Right. But it was mad realistic. Like it was wild, ridiculous that children were able to play this game. And so we were trying to, you know, wanted to play it, except there was this cop in uniform who was playing Lethal Enforcers and had all his quarters up or whatever. And he was playing by himself. And obviously nobody was supposed to like jump in the game because the cop had. And so you imagine just being in the arcade and this dude looking like the big boss man is just pointing this pistol. Bow, bow, bow. He was a beast. Bow, bow, bow. He was killing it. And then my partner, who always got things a little bit wrong, something happened. He put his elbow down on the machine and he hit one of the player buttons.
Ooh.
And so now the joint is active. Right. Yeah. So now the joint is active. And my boy Will sees this happening and is like, oh, shit. So he grabs the gun, you know, makes himself useful and starts shooting. The cop is now furious.
That's like bumping a DJ table.
And he has noticed. And I'll just never forget, the cop looks at my boy and was like, you got 50 cents? Because he had already put the credits in, right? And the boy was like, no. Well, I suggest you get the f*** away from me. We were like 15.
Yeah.
Cop ran us out over 50 cents.
Right. Can you use his credits, man? He had his afternoon planned.
He was heated, man. Anyway, Gabe, we got one more?
Yeah, one last good one. And it's also from JD in Singapore.
Which of the championship teams throughout the 90s for the Bulls you thought was the best?
All right, so I included this question because I thought there was a perfect follow-up to it. So to JD's question, who was the best team out of that whole Bulls run from the 90s? But then B, which team that they faced in light of the series that you did, Bomani, called Bulldozed, what was the best team that they faced along the way?
The best of those Bulls teams were the 92 and the 96. Right. Like the 92 team was just a monster. And the 96 is the one that won the 72 games. Yeah. Like those are the two that I probably point to as the best. Who you got?
96 is first. And then I think the year after, 96, 97, I go with them.
I just won 69 games.
Yeah. Low key. Yeah. And then just the Rodman. I feel like the second iteration, the second three-peat group was to me better than the first one.
But I think it was a better Jordan in the first three-peat.
Yeah.
That's the key. It's a better Jordan.
Which makes everything better.
Like 92 is probably peak Jordan. Mm-hmm. That's it. Now, other teams they beat, who you got?
See, I don't want to conflate the team that took them the farthest with the best one. Because, I mean, I'm inclined to go Indiana. They were at the end of their run. So, oh, wait, are we talking East or are we talking about across the board?
Whichever way you want to go.
I got to go Utah, man. I'm sorry. I mean, they kept Stockton and Malone back out of it twice. I got to go Utah.
Now, I think the 96 Sonics were better than both of those Jazz squads. I look at the 96 Sonics and the 93 Suns.
Okay.
Like, as the teams they went to the finals against.
Yeah.
Because I would also say that, like, of the – aside from 91 Magic, which was still incredible, like, 93 Barkley is the best player that they ran up on in the NBA Finals. Like, for a one season. Yeah. 93 Barkley might be the best out of all those years, like aside, you know, like a guy in the league, aside from like monstrous Shaq in that second run. 93 Barkley might have been the best season anybody had put up, you know, of like a real contender that they were.
No argument here. No argument here with Barkley. I mean, I did enjoy that aspect of it, like in terms of like supporting actors in this thing. Just getting a chance to get a glimpse and a reminder of how dope Barkley is. Because you're talking about kids. We're talking about Jordan. Like, these kids don't remember. These kids don't know who Chuck was. They know Chuck is that Draymond Green goes at, this dude on TNT. Like, Charles Barkley was nothing to f*** around with.
Before the evolution of the power forward, he, to me, was the greatest power forward of all time. Hmm. Like, before you get to Garnett and Dirk Nowitzki, I don't know if he counts, but you know what I mean. Like, before Tim Duncan... Like, and even he is at a center, right? But before we get to those guys, the answer was Charles Barkley. Hey, but ladies and gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us here on The Right Time. My man, Michael Smith, thank you so much. Greatly appreciate it.
Thank you, brother. Always a pleasure. Let's do it again soon.
All right, man, will do. And thank you to our sponsor, Marathon. Also, my man Gabe Bassain handles everything behind the scenes. Thank you, sir. Remember, subscribe to The Right Time. Rate us, review us, give us 5 stars. You only give us 4 stars. I'm inclined to believe you are a hater. We'll talk to you guys in a couple of days. Take it easy.
Thanks for checking out the Right Time with Bomani Jones podcast.
You can listen or subscribe on the ESPN app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
The Right Time
with Bomani Jones.